Hi folks, and welcome to another video in a world where time windows are so short that I'm uploading one video, rendering a second, and recording a third. Yeah. While also watching Brian J play his latest live episode of Shadecraft. Yeah. He's currently stealing his villagers' carrots. Or rather, oddly for a thief, he seems to be putting them back, but yeah, let's not go there. In this video, I'm going to cram an awful lot in. We're going to start off with a Minecraft update. Then we're going to go on to an electronics update. We're going to finish off the Doctor Who discussion from my angle. And then we're going to go into the news, views, and all the rest of it. News, views, and linky poos. That rhymes. Yeah, enough of that. Minecraft. The episode that's currently rendering is where I make the final changes to the world before uploading it to the server. Pretty much, the second discussion, I think, has come to the conclusion that, yeah, let's do it, let's see how it goes. After all, Brian will be playing at different time windows to me, and even when we are both on the server together, we'll be chatting by text, so the piece to the camera will still be me to you. So it's going to be interesting, especially to see what Brian does to the castle. His gameplay coming into this will be to come into an abandoned building, so it'll be interesting to watch, and I'll be watching his videos as he does them. His time and recording will be separate to mine. There may be the odd occasions where we do something together, but again, it will be text chat. Yeah. So, it's going to be very interesting, to put it mildly. yeah. There's not much else to say on that score, really. It's pretty much doing what it's doing. I think I'm about six or so, there's another six. I accidentally let loose two episodes at the same time. Sorry about that. It was a button push error on my part, so I'll take the blame for that. Where are we? Slow on the internet. That's where we are, because I'm uploading. Wow. Okay, 148 views on the slight electronics update. looks like somebody's watching those two videos out of sequence, but there you go. There are four more before the shaders kick in. And then there's going to be two shader episodes, and then we're going to be onto the server, so there's about six episodes left unpublished at the moment. The last one published was 131, the beginning of the end. So, yeah, that's roughly where we are. I'll be playing on the server under my MSKnight55 account, which doesn't have any admin privs. And Brian, I think, is going to do the same when it comes to the single-player world. we've each got more than one account. Moving on to the electronics side of things, you've probably already seen the video that's uploading now, which you'll have seen, is the server sort out. Yeah, a few disasters, but it's looking a lot better, a lot healthier, a lot less dustier, and I finally got the side on that PC that's handling the game servers. I've also changed the UPS, but that's another issue. By the time you've watched this, yeah. So, the Xboxes are the next issue. I think I was actually quite fortunate in that all three of the Xboxes that I've got are all 1.6 variants, so there's no clock issue, and they all have the same Samsung Revision A DVDs. Now, I thought that I was going to I ordered three of these and they arrived. Unfortunately, they're slightly the wrong model. So I'm having trouble tracking down the correct model because a lot of the Western places are not stocking them, or the very few that are want stupid money for them in the US, and then want postage on top of that, which will also increase the import costs. I'm trying to negotiate with various places in Shenzhen. It's getting a bit dodgy, getting a bit dicey. But I've managed to get onto a system which is basically a Chinese marketplace. And I've also emailed Serpent ZA to see if he can help. I don't know if he can or can't. If you don't ask the question, you don't get the answer. If you can, bonus. But long story short is I've hit a load of people who seem to be trying it on. Yeah. So we'll see where it goes, but I'm really stuck until I get the optical heads, the optical pickups as they're called for the Samsung DVD-ROM drives. I'm just lucky that all three are the same model. Now I'm working on one of the two, and I have the other one, which is basically being kept as it was, which is basically all I've done is taken the lid off it. It's still dusty as hell, so you'll be able to see the cleaner at work. I've obviously got to do the optics on the DVD drive, so you'll see me take that to pieces and also clean it out and do the rest of it. So basically on the one, I'm going to practice and get everything sorted so I know what I'm doing, make my mistakes on that one before actually doing it on that one, because that way you're not left with days between finding out, oh damn, I need another part, and then getting that organized. I can do it all in a few short videos in close together time for you. These have also arrived, and these, if you can see through the plastic, are actually three Aladdin units. They're not actually Aladdins, they're clone Aladdins. Executor 3s are as rare as hen's teeth. They've stopped. The real Aladdins have stopped. There are occasional Xboxes popping up on eBay with Executor 3s, but there's an entire community that are looking for these machines, and they're going for more money than I can realistically put to one side, really. There's other things going on. So yeah, that's what's happening. Next weekend I should be learning how to surface solder, or to how to solder surface mount components. So we're going to see if I'm much of a success at that. So once we try that, then I've got a few more solder projects to do. Everything's been on a sort of hiatus on that side until I could organize this particular window of time to learn. Slightly stepping out of the electronics side. I'm starting to go for the Pink Floyd albums, remastered 160 GSM. I've got to. I'll see what they're like. One of my friends has got all of that lot, basically the originals. So we're gonna sit back with a glass of wine and a pair of headphones and listen to them and see what the differences are, really. I wasn't originally going to go for the Pink Floyd remastered. I wasn't originally going to go for Pink Floyd at all. And then I heard a few tracks. You know the old thing, it stirs memories and think, okay, well, if I do it gradually, it'll be a collection to be engaged with. Because if you some of these things, the collection itself is the joy, if you know what I mean. And I could just hop onto Discogs and buy up all the old ones, no problem. But the new ones, we'll see what happens. We'll see what happens. To the Doctor Who side of those arguments, I didn't think that Grim Jim was actually going to see my last video. But he did, apparently, and there was somebody else's that he saw, and he made a response video. I'm not following Grim Jim, so I didn't see it. I have no intention of seeing it. It was merely told by someone else that it existed. I asked the obvious question, did he put anything forward to actually support his original arguments? The answer was no, and apparently the discussion went along the lines of how do I explain it? The old argument that all babies or all babies are atheists statement, and the argument about that. If you're not used to that argument, just think the old point is zero a number, and you'll quickly get the idea that when you get to those kind of questions, it's evident that either people have forgotten the question or they don't want to remember the question. So, absolutely pointless me watching that video or participating in that argument anymore because it's basically had it. We're gonna merge that with the news and views now, so we're going to be into the fourth section very shortly. Because a few more things cropped up in the news that also counter one of Grim Jim's earlier arguments, that the response to this imagined outrage that it's a woman is far bigger than any actual outrage that it is that it's a woman. Yeah, it's an outrage. Two former doctors clash over Jodie Whittaker casting. Peter Davidson was of the view that it should always be a man, and Colin Baker basically took him to task over it. This all happened on Twitter, I think. Also, from the sublime to the ridiculous, Jodie's taking over the TARDIS was celebrated by John Barrowman, dressed in a sparkly TARDIS tutu to honour the new Doctor Who star Jodie Whittaker. Yes, you read that right. John Barrowman dressed in a sparkly TARDIS tutu, and apparently during his stint on stage, he declared himself to be the transsexual TARDIS. Okay, John. Whatever floats your boat, I guess. Anyway, so that's that on that. We now go into some technological news group. Those two links were on their own. We're now starting another section. Bitcoin swings as civil war looms. Yeah, Bitcoin seems to be in a bit of an issue. I personally haven't got any myself because I, it's. When you're going into these new experimental currencies, it's like a gamble, and with any gamble, you can only gamble money that you can afford to lose, and I can't afford to lose any. So basically, it's up and down, and there's a whole. It's volatile, basically, for all sorts of reasons. Cryptocurrency is certainly one of the reasons why you can't get a decent graphics card for love nor money without paying an absolute fortune through the nose for it. But there you go, that's another argument. Yeah, I'll leave you to ring that, read that. In Britain, we are getting registration for drones. That's going to be a good one. The drones have hit the news for a while because of the way they've been used. One of the chief drone manufacturers, DJI, has been doing all sorts, including upgrading the BIOS to have, or firmware rather, to have certain geolocation no-fly zones, height, flight limits, and all sorts of bits and pieces like that. There have been hackers on the system because apparently DJI left a back door open. This is going to be one of those cat and mouse wars that's going to exist in technology forevermore, I think. But now the UK government is going over to drone registration. Pretty much, I think this is down to the irresponsible actions of a few, and we're all going to have to pay the price. This, as far as I could see, was going to be inevitable, which is one reason why I never bothered to get into the drones. Nice, it would be absolutely glorious to be able to have some overhead drone shots to be able to add into videos. But here, there's that practicality side of things. So exactly how the heck they're going to enforce this, I don't know. I haven't got a clue. And to be honest, I don't think that they've got a clue either. So, yeah. Apparently, for those legitimate law-abiding users, if they want somebody to shout at, then shout at the not-so-law-abiding users, I believe. Anyway, that's going to run its own course. Also in IT, Solaris and Java have vulnerabilities that let users run riot. Again, Java being an issue on this. Solaris, or basically OpenIndiana, which is a Solaris fork, is what I run on my main server. I haven't actually got Java loaded on it, so I'm not particularly at risk of this one. But I haven't got any of these libraries loaded. But I think one of the key things is Java SE has 10 critical flaws, 9 of them rated 9.6. Most allow remote users to do things you'd rather they couldn't. But now you get there's something terrifying for almost every Oracle user, because even a bug rated at a wimpy 5.3, such as blah blah, discovered by Anapsis means attackers to exfiltrate sensitive business data without requiring a valid user account. Not good. Not good at all. So yeah, with most exploits, you've got to already be at certain positions in the network in order to execute them. So yeah. In other news of yet more government stuff not knowing what the hell it's doing, the PAWN ID checks are set to start in April next year for the UK, whereas any PAWN site that's being browsed in the UK must have some sort of age identity verification check, and not the usual tick box, but something hard like a credit card check. It's interesting that the government themselves haven't got a clue what how they're going to do this, and they've passed the entire responsibility on to what is effectively a quango, I think, whoever it is, the unlucky sod that's going to have to attempt to put this into practice. Because, I've already been firing at my MP various things saying, this is not going to work. I mean, it doesn't take much to look up the fact that things have changed. In the old days, as kids, we used to run with our 50p down to the sweet shop for a few gewgaws or whatever the hell they're called. but these days, it's electronic. We're in tap technology. Tap with your wristwatch, which has to be tied to a credit card. There are credit cards available of various types to people who are under 18. Anyway. So how the hell they're going to police this is anybody's guess, but as usual, the government have taken all the criticism and technical issues on board, ignored them, and carried on anyway, and pushed the responsibility for overcoming the impossible to somebody else. Wonderful, isn't it? So there you go on that one. SQL. Microsoft SQL is now available as a first candidate on Linux. It was announced some time ago, so we knew it was coming, but now the first release candidate is out and about for you to have a look at. Linux support for Tier 1 mission-critical workloads. SQL Server 2017 support for Linux includes the same high availability solutions on Linux as Windows servers, including always-on availability groups integrated with Linux native clustering solutions like Pacemaker and all sorts of other bits and pieces. Exactly what the hell is going to come of this, I don't know. Part of me wonders if Windows Server actually has a future. At the moment, effectively, long story short, you've got Windows Server and Windows Client. With Windows Server, I believe, is morphing into cloud services. So you don't really run the Windows Server anymore, you have a cloud service, and the fact that it's Linux behind it, who the hell cares? As long as they're running a service that they can charge you a license fee for, why the hell should Microsoft worry? I think anyone who's got infrastructure on site, on prem, needs to worry, because if Windows Server itself could potentially be kicked into the long grass in due course, what the hell are they going to do? the way that this is shaping up, I don't like. It could go any which way. This is purely a, this is the way it looks to me. I've got nothing other than the bits and pieces that I'm feeding on right now. But yeah. I'm hearing more and more of businesses actually coming out of the cloud for various workloads. It's a great dev environment, but when it comes to production, it suits some workloads but not others. And a chunk of the traditional workloads, it doesn't suit. And that's entirely the problem. If you want to shift those workloads to the cloud, you've got to morph the model. You've got to morph the product. Just taking a standard server room product and sticking it in the cloud isn't really giving you that much. It's got to be designed for the cloud, in my personal opinion, before it's really going to reap any benefits of being cloud. And that's just not the case for a chunk of stuff. There's a few more tech stuff, three more, and I've gone orange. I'm not going to fit them in the remainder of orange time. See you in a moment. Okay, Google are adding a news feed to the website and the app. A personalized Facebook-style news feed to its homepage to show users content they may be interested in before they search. This indicates yet another of Google's philosophies that they are throwing completely out of the pram. You know, it should be minimalist and yada yada, and they've even got a patent on it, and they've actually gone after other websites for breaching their patent. And here they are now, busying up their homepage with personalized articles that they think. All I'm reading are complaints from people who have been doing this or thinking about it. The way that some of this stuff that I've been reading makes me, its reporting makes me believe there's been a beta group of this. The stuff I'm reading is not encouraging me. Basically, people are saying that they've been idly browsing for this, that, or the other, and all of a sudden, the stuff that's coming up in the feed is stuff that they've just casually browsed. It doesn't actually mean anything to them, and actually, it's taking their time away because they've got to read it and evaluate that actually this is a load of trash. So, yeah, this is yet something else that's not going to end well. Did I actually put that in? No, I didn't. What else did I put in? Yeah, this is going to be the first link in group three. Darknet guns shipped in old printers. This is an interesting one. Long story short is that the way I read this is you can buy, say, for example, a printer, a second-hand printer, and on that printer will happen to be the files to print a gun. And that's one way of getting things from A to B without alarming any security or border or anybody, because you're not, you know, it's. Yeah. That's going to be an interesting one. It's going to be an interesting one for law enforcement and actually society, because the degree of privacy that will have to be thrown straight out the window for this to happen, in order to be able to crack down on something like this, you've got to be out of your tree. It's nuts. It's absolutely stupid. And especially if you're buying something from another country, how is customs going to know what's actually what firmware or ones and zeros are on a particular device? You know, I mean, if you come across a USB stick or something like that, that would immediately trigger, oh, I wonder what's on this. But if you ship a printer or something like that with no obvious, you don't even think about it. What's going to happen? Are customs going to have to stop every item, plug it in, and read its entire memory? If that's coming in the future, God help me if you try and import anything. You'll be waiting years. Social networks lead to anxiety and fear in young. Research from anti-bullying charity Ditch the Label suggests social media is making youngsters more anxious. 40% said they felt bad if nobody liked their selfie, and 35% said their confidence was directly linked to the number of followers they had. This isn't news, talked about it before, but I suppose that what is news is that still nobody seems to have done anything about this. Where are our schools? Where are the parents? What is it that makes these young people get their self-esteem from social media? What is happening that they're not getting their self-esteem from other places? Why aren't they getting it from achieving in class or at school or whatever? Why do they feel that their sense of self is so linked to social media? I think there's a larger question there, not just the social media aspect, but the aspect of the lives of the younger generation in the modern world that our politicians and all the rest of it just seem to have no grasp of, totally no grasp of, and the worrying thing, no desire to get to grips with it. I mean, it's okay. This is a problem. This is a problem. This is a problem. Yeah, but when is somebody actually going to deal with the solution to this? That's the key thing. We run sort of out of tech and into social media-ish, with Justin Bieber being banned from China for bad behavior. If you're a follower of SerpentZA, Lahawei 86, you'll pretty much know what's been going on in China. Pretty much, it's a story. The story of China cracking down on the Great Firewall and VPNs is one which keeps hitting, and they'll only believe it when it happens. There was something else in here. Have I got it here? Do I have it here? No. But the long story short was, something happened in China, and the Chinese people aren't very happy about it. And I've said it before, I think China is in for a change. It won't happen this generation, probably won't happen in my lifetime, but it's starting to happen. Whereas people will, there could be another revolution if the government goes that far as to censor the internet. There was also a thing about gay censorship going on, and the modern people don't like it, and they're taking issue with the government over it. This is adding to the voices, taking the government to task for failing to deal with the pollution issues in China. And yeah, it's going to get very interesting. I think China is going to have potentially another revolution on its hands, and I don't think it's going to have the ability to stop it. Yeah. So the word on the street is that SerpentZA will believe it when he sees it. He doesn't think it'll happen purely because the backlash from their own people, I think, would be so massive, and it would have such an impact on business, because China does require to talk with the outside world, so they can't just, you know. It's another thing of political will and scaring people and potentially not knowing how the hell they're going to do it. talking about social and yada yada and stars and blah. Here's one of where do I start? Tippi Hedren. In the birds, never seen it, but apparently she had a pet lion during the 1970s. Yep, a pet lion. It's a 4-page article, and fortunately no one got seriously hurt, but there were some incidents which eventually led her to believe perhaps we'd better not have this lion in the house. It was just an interesting one to read. First link in group 4 is the police overstretching their powers. I mean, if you've watched Blue Thunder and watching, where is it, Downtown, where was it, basically, there was somebody who did naked yoga in the window, and it was apparently a known thing. So the police helicopters went down and took a look. Well, apparently this lot did this in real life, and got caught. And it's going to be interesting to see what. Mr. Wright said the couple shared Progmore's interest in swinging, and added it was no coincidence that the helicopter flew above while they brazenly put on a show. The accused denied the charges and, in short, blamed Pogmore for what happened, Mr. Wright said. A couple sitting naked by a caravan were also filmed unawares in July 2008, and the aircraft filmed the garden where a woman was sunbathing naked with her daughters in 2007. Yeah. Frigging Nora. And this was, some of this looked like 2007, 2008. How the hell is this only hitting now? Yeah, it's... Did someone wait until recently to review the tapes? BBC stars pay to be revealed in annual report. This is interesting. It's gone on a few notches since this actual article itself, and the report has come out. A number of stars have been named, everyone over earning over 150,000. I don't think they've given the precise figure, but boy, some are in the millions. And it's going to be interesting to see what happens. The discussion is actually quite deep. It's not as straightforward as the headlines say, because different stars do different amounts of work, and some do a fair number of shows. But the kind of money that's being... when you're talking big figures, it's one of those angering things. I mean, Gary Lineker, when all this was first unfolding, it turned out that Gary Lineker had turned down higher pay to go to a competitor because he wanted to stay with the BBC. I thought, wow, that's cool. Good on him for that. And then it turned out that he was number 2 on the list. Okay, I don't know what to think about this anymore. How we're really going to get a handle on this, I don't know. Even if we are ever going to get a handle on it. And I don't know what this is going to mean for various bits and pieces. I honestly don't know. The whole thing about some of these stars is, you know, it's difficult. You know, their security has to be higher. There's different demands on their lives. I don't know. I really don't know what to think about all this. Pretty much because the whole thing is so far outside my experience that I've got no real easy reference with which to start grasping this. yeah, there's a lot of emotive stuff in here, and I'm still just wrapping my head around it, to be perfectly honest. Some very large figures. Personally, I've sort of been of the opinion that if someone demands more money for their worth, then just let them go and get somebody else, because there are people out there who have talent and actually want to be somewhere because they want to be there, or working for someone because they want to work for something for that particular person, organization, whatever. And we should be finding those people, not only in stardom but in all aspects of business. One of the old reasons is you've got to pay someone more, otherwise they'll go somewhere else. It's unsustainable. It's just totally unsustainable, and it's one of the things which I believe has led to the degree of social inequality that we've got at the moment. But what's going to be done about it? I don't know. I don't think anything will. Next one. There are two links here, and it's got to the point where you've got the headline on MSFP News is "Woman Hospitalized, Unable to Feel Her Legs After Somali Immigrant Attacks Her for Walking Unclean Dogs." And next one, "Muslim Campaign to Ban Dogs in Public Places. Is it an Islamophobic Hoax?" That second one happened in the middle of last year, about a year ago, basically. Leaflets got pushed through letterboxes. It's got to the point, I've tried to work out whether or not these things are true, because it's got to the stage now where I don't even know. There's stuff going on. I can't even check that it's true. I don't know whether I can trust what I'm reading enough to be able to form an opinion about it. It's crazy. Absolutely, utterly crazy. I don't know whether those things are true or not. And if you read them, and I've tried to research. I mean, I have to admit that I forwarded those to Snopes. They may actually have something, by the way, by now. I don't know. Let's have a look. Pardon me, it's still uploading the video. Another 19 minutes remaining, by which time hopefully I'd have finished this one. How long has the other one got to render? Because that's not taking over 3 hours 14 minutes. Why? Ah, here we go. Have they got it listed? Can't immediately see it. Oh. Spicer resigns as White House Secretary, yep. So it looks like I'm going to have to. Woman confuses spray foam insulation for moose. Okay. Okay, now we're starting to go into table mode, so I should be able to get through this a degree more quickly. No, it doesn't look like they've actually covered it yet. Some really weird stuff on here. Okay. No. No chance on that one. Yeah, so I've just got no frigging clue. First link, group 5, UK to ban companies from charging credit card fees. We have even got debit cards, which are effectively, they're touting as the replacement to cash. But, you know, you walk into a shop and they'll say a minimum purchase of £5 or £10 even in some places. Otherwise, you wind up with a fee. And that's not the way that this whole thing was touted. It was supposed to be an end to cash, an end to needing to carry cash, and you've just got electronic means of payment. But the transaction fees that are leveraged on that has basically completely scuppered that for day-to-day, everyday little bits and pieces shopping use. But now, and it is quite serious. Following a directive from the European Union, which bans surcharges on Visa and MasterCard payments, the government has decided to also ban charges on American Express, PayPal, Apple Pay and others too. In 2010 alone, consumers spent £473 million on credit card charges, according to estimates by the UK Treasury, with the worst offenders being airlines and small businesses, which typically add a fee for taking credit card payments. Good to know that it's finally ending. And we're going to go start to move into politics and bits and pieces-ish. And I've gone orange again. Article: Are you ready to consider that capitalism is the real problem? Before you say no, take a moment to really ask yourself whether it's the system that's best suited to build our future society. Interesting article. And this is basically built on the Trevor Hill meeting in New York with the question posed to Nancy Pelosi. I did notice that was actually cut short after she said what she said. The video abruptly cuts. I would have liked to hear more of her answer. But it sparked more discussions, and especially the discussion about finding the middle way between capitalism and socialism. And one of the questions that I posed in a discussion on Facebook, really, is when it comes to things like police, those things can't really be purchased by the individual at the time. I mean, what are you going to do? Pay nothing towards the police? And then all of a sudden, when you get a burglar, then all of a sudden pay the police to catch the criminal? And what about the jail system? If that thief goes to jail, who's going to pay for the thief to be kept there? You know, are you actually going to wind up being in the situation where if somebody burgles you and you pay to have them caught and put in jail, are you going to pay to keep them in jail, you know, because it was you that they burgled and you're the one that wants them kept there? It's society needs to run. There's got to be a middle way. You can't just say taxes are theft, no to taxes, and leave it at that. You know, that there are aspects of society like protection. I mean, we in a commercial society, we like to be able to go and buy our services. And who's going to police things like the Phoebus cartel and all the other fixing things that go on? You know, who's going to police those things on our behalf? Because if you don't have some sort of governance over these things and some sort of policing going on, then manufacturers and retailers and whoever are going to be able to collude and fix the markets, you're paying well over the odds. if that's how you imagine commercialism working, then good luck to you. You probably won't have very much money for very long. Some time ago, I was talking about what's going to happen as things happen in society, and that we're going to see more crime, more burglaries, particularly as people become poorer, relatively poorer. And yeah, apparently we've had the largest crime rise in England and Wales for 10 years. That's also tied in with this next one, burglary and theft top for unsolved crimes. And I reckon it's just going to get higher and higher myself, because we've also got this next one, which is young families hit by income slowdown. If people can't afford the nice things in life, then we're going to see an increase in robberies, burglaries, and with less police, who's going to solve these things? Who's going to, you know, the only thing that you can do is hope that your insurance premium is paid up. And, yeah, if anything meant anything, good luck, you'll never see it again. I've been burgled a couple of times in my life. It wasn't very funny, and I just don't keep anything that's that precious anymore. It's not worth it. What do you do? What do you do? You take whatever steps you can to halt the opportunist, and that is one of the major things. There's a spider on the window. In fact, there's two. I'll have to take care of this. Yeah. You're not going to stop the determined burglar, but a lot of stuff is down to opportunist burglars. Just be sensible, really, I think, is the only thing. But it's not surprising me to read those headlines now. Not surprising at all. What's that? Yeah, talking about lack of money, rise in life expectancy is levelling off. This is the first link in Group 6. Austerity may be starting to affect life expectancy in England, according to a leading health expert. Life expectancy has been rising for decades, but the latest data shows the rate of increase has slowed. University College London expert Sir Michael Marmot said he was deeply concerned by the situation, saying it was entirely possible austerity was affecting how long people live. His suggestion has been dismissed by the government, however. Ha ha. Yeah, like that surprises me. The Department of Health said it was providing the necessary support and funding to ensure life expectancy continues to increase. Well, they've got to, because that's the judgment that they're using. That's the justification that they're using for slamming the workers with ever more increasing age before you can claim state benefits. I think it's jumped up to now 67. I think we got hit with another year. Since I've been working where I am, which is more than a decade, we've had our pensions tweaked 3 times. You know, and not tweaked in a good way. So it's going to be interesting to watch this going on and what the government's reaction to it is going to be. But the government have been using increasing life expectancy to offset the costs in social care, in state retirement benefits. It's actually having a negative effect because people are working longer, which means that the younger generation aren't able to get into the workforce as readily, because posts which would have been freed up by people retiring are not being freed up anymore. It's a whole balance, and the more that the government push the age before retirement, it's a very odd, even what I've put forward is a hugely simplistic view of part of the balance. But it's, if this gains even more legs, then and voices increase in the government, to say, you can't ignore this, you've got no justification for doing what you're doing anymore. It's going to be interesting to see what happens. But, yeah. It's an interesting one. One thing which really caught people's attention was a girl who was 5 who was fined £150 for operating a lemonade stand without a license. Upset the kid. I don't suppose that the lemonade sales came anywhere near to paying that £150 fine. You got the thing that the law is the law. But, you know, one of the things that we need certain freedoms, you know, and teaching children a bit of entrepreneurship, this is the thing where there is a line, there is a right, there is a wrong. She should have paid a license. But a 5-year-old child paying a license for selling lemonade, you know, this just feels like what the actual fuck. You know, that's how it feels to me. Jeez. You know, I did take my hat off to Linus in Linus's Tech Tips some time ago when he did things like showed how to run the lawn mowing business and also tried the roadside stall stand selling fruit in order to save up money for a laptop, and actually encouraged the younger viewers to the channel to actually do these things and to take responsibility for their money and energize them into doing things as opposed to just turning to mum and dad. But when you get stuff like this going on, it's what the actual hell. Europe. I think we've only got 2 actual politics posts that are out and out politics. The Polish president urged by the EU to veto judicial independence bill. Now, this may be a Brexit or a po-exit by the back door. They may actually wind up getting kicked out of Europe if they don't do something about this. It looks like Poland is going, I wouldn't say rogue, but it certainly looks that if they continue along this path, then it does look like they probably will get kicked out of the EU in due course. And contribute even further to the EU's demise. That's going to be an interesting one to watch. Very interesting. Because I don't see how it's possible for the EU to actually fine them for doing that or really do much in the way of sanctions. Yeah. Grenfell cladding, 14 times combustibility limit. This is a fairly major article on the tower issue, on the technical side of the issue, rather than the humanitarian disaster. Burning cladding on Grenfell Tower would have released 14 times more heat than a key government safety test allows, the BBC has learned. Energy emitted from the cladding and insulation would have been equivalent to burning 51 tons of pine wood, University of Leeds research suggests. The cladding's plastic core would have burned as quickly as petrol, it said. The contractors who fitted the cladding and insulation said they both passed all regulations. This is, you know, it's like playing responsibility ping pong. Yeah. What do you say? I think the humanitarian side of things is still, as in the human impact, is still of the event is still going on in terms of not enough people really having somewhere else that they can start to rebuild from, for want of a better way of putting it. As in somewhere new that they can start to rebuild their lives from. The council was heckled at a meeting. Sorry, I'm tired and I'm starting to lose my concentration and I'm not using the right words totally. So I think I'll call this a night. But yeah, it's absolutely bonkers what's happening. Absolutely bonkers. I've got to set this video up for it's gonna have to render throughout the night. No, it won't even be up till the next day. Oh well. So, anyway, I think that's about it. There was more information on the technical side of the Grenfell tower testing, but exactly who is responsible or what element of the system failed is going to be interesting, to put it mildly. The only thing that I'm really sad about this process is that it won't. This messing around like this will do nothing to bring closure for the people who are affected by this. This ping-ponging of yes, but it was within the regulation spec, or what the regulation spec say when they say you a bunch of words and okay, who made this decision? I can't see it actually reaching some sort of okay, well, this was the key thing that we need to change. This was responsibility that the ultimate reason why what happened happened, and without that, I don't think that it's going to allow, it's going to be a constantly open chapter, painful, hideously painful chapter in many people's lives. And this political insanity, for want of a better word, is just. I'm tired. I need bed. You'll see this when you see this. And I'll see you on the next video. Until then, bye for now.